Hallelujah. Praise God. I don't know that I can talk. Hallelujah. Well, that's the point, isn't it? Let God's glory fill this place. Let God's glory fill His temple. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 says, we are the temple of the living God, individually and collectively. Let the glory of God fill this place by the power of the Spirit. Brethren, do you know that we're called to live in the Spirit? Amen. We were born in Adam. We were born according to the flesh. But it wasn't enough. God did not resolve to change our life. God has not called us to a changed life. Adam cannot be rehabilitated. Adam is destined to die because Adam's nature is a fallen nature. Adam can't be fixed. Adam needs new life. Adam must die. Adam will be crucified on the cross with Christ. All those who receive the Lord. Or Adam will perish and die in the lake of fire. But Adam is going to die. If you come to Christ, Adam has been crucified. We were crucified with Christ, yet we live. And it's not us who lives. It's Christ who lives His life in us. By the power of the Spirit of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 says, Jesus Himself is the Spirit. It is His life in us. It is our hope for glory. In Adam we die. Jesus told Nicodemus, Nicodemus, it's not enough to be born of the flesh. It's not enough to be born of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You can't see the kingdom because you're born of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You can't see the kingdom. You can't enter the kingdom. You must be born again. That which is a flesh is flesh. That which is a spirit is spirit. We must live according to the Spirit. That means we don't quench the Spirit. When we quench the Spirit, we quench the life of Christ in us. Amen. How do we know we're living in the Spirit? 1 John chapter 3 says that the person that is born again does not sin, does not practice sin. Does the law save us? Law has no power to save us. The commandments is the ministry of death, we find in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. It wasn't meant to be, but it became the ministry of death because we all disobeyed. And the wages of sin is death, amen? Because we disobeyed God, what Paul said in Romans, what was meant for life for me became death for me. Why? Because there was fault with God's instruction, His law, His commandment? No. Because He found fault with us. Because we disobeyed God's instruction. From the very beginning, Adam disobeyed God. And because of that, he fell from the grace of God. He followed his own will rather than the will of God. So God's response was not, well, I'll fix you, Adam. God's response was, you must die. And there has to be another Adam. There has to be a last Adam. His name is Jesus. We find in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And the last Adam is a life-giving spirit. And that spirit God has placed in all of us who have received the sacrifice of Christ, be baptized into His death and risen into His life. If we've died with Him, we've been risen with Him. Amen. And even now, our life is seated in heavenly places. Our life is hidden in Christ Jesus. But we can quench the Spirit. We can choose to choke the Spirit. We can choose to feed the flesh and the desires of the flesh. You know, Genesis chapter 6, when man was going astray, you know, in the Hebrew, it says, my spirit, God says, cannot abide in man. My spirit cannot rule man. Why is that? Because in his him going after the flesh, he goes astray and becomes flesh. Amen. You will become whatever you feed. You will move in the direction of your most dominant thought. Whatever your heart's desire is what you're going to receive. If you want the things of this world, you're going to get them. You can have them. Jesus told the Pharisees, "Behold, you have your reward." You want to be respected by men? You want to be honored by men? You want a place of prestige? You want to sit in the prominent places? Okay, you can. You can do that. You can have whatever you want. If you want the things of this world, you can have them. If you want to go to hell, go on. Go on, go to hell. And that's what I tell people. Listen, if you want to go to hell, go ahead. Go ahead. I mean, it's your choice. God said in the very beginning, "I set before you life and death. Now, I counsel you to choose life." You were created for life. And hell was not created for you. It was created for the fallen angels and the devil. But if you want to join the rebellion, if you want to join forces with them, if you want to join with the forces of darkness, go ahead. You want to be a part of the world? Go ahead. Perish with the world. God is a righteous judge. God has done what he could do. When the first Adam fell, he sent a second Adam, a life-giving spirit that lived a perfect life, that left his divinity in heaven. Philippians chapter 2 said he was equal with God in the beginning, but he emptied himself and became a man, not only becoming a man and suffering sorrow and betrayal his entire life, well acquainted with afflictions and sicknesses. He then he submitted himself to death, even on the cross. He subjected himself to separation from his Father. He was alone. That was our fate. He has done what he could do. He has given a righteous sacrifice. Those who do not value the sacrifice of Christ do not deserve salvation. And I'll say you this, they don't want it. They don't want it. Because how you know what you want is in what you do. What you pursue, you will move in the direction of your most dominant thought. Whatever you want in this life or in the life to come, you'll get it. Behold, you receive your reward. I seek for glory. I seek for eternal life. That means I buffet my body today. That means I take the flesh by the neck and I say, "You're going to submit to the will of God." I don't shadow box. I aim to hit something. And when I hit it, I mean to hurt it. I mean to knock it out. Amen. And when that body of death raises up, I push it down. Because I'm not, you see, the slave is dead. Is the old sin master still around? Yeah, the sin master's still around. But the slave is dead. The slave died on the cross of Calvary with Jesus. Romans 6. The slave died. The slave Larry Lasiter, born of Adam, born according to the flesh, died with Christ, was crucified with him on the cross of Calvary, and was risen with him. And now my life is in him. It's not I who live, but he lives. You know what Paul said in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20? I've been crucified with Christ, yet I live. Yet it is not me who lives, he lives in me. How come he doesn't live? Because he was crucified with Christ. When you're crucified, you die. So who you are in Adam is dead. And now you are alive in Christ. And that's it. Now listen. In Adam, we were born according to a fallen race. In Christ, we're born again of a risen race. Amen. And in Christ, we have power. But in Adam, we have no power. Listen, you cannot obey God in the flesh. Adam cannot please God. Adam cannot obey God. Adam can temporarily do things. Anybody in Adam can temporarily be convicted by their conscience and try to do something for God. But they'll do according to their own will. They'll do it according to their own standard. They'll say, I'm deciding how I'm going to serve you, Lord. That's the truth. It takes the life of Christ. It takes the Holy Spirit to convict us, to come and to change our hearts to where we don't say, okay, I'm going to give this to you, Lord. It's saying, I'm not going to give this to you. You own it. And let your glory fill this place. And you live your life in me unhindered. Amen. Unhindered. And let it be a glorious light. Let everyone else see it. Amen. We're not only called as those who go out to try to present the gospel to save people. We're witnesses. Amen. You know, the Apostle Peter, when he stood up on the day of Pentecost, he just did not say, come and be saved. He said, this is what's going to happen if you don't. This is your fate in Adam. And it doesn't matter how much commandment keeping or how much law keeping you do, but the law cannot wash away sins. The blood washes away sins. Okay, we had a problem, didn't we? We're born of Adam, so we are sinners by nature. Right or wrong? We're sinners by nature. Now we have sins against us. So what did God do to deal with the sins against us? The blood of Jesus. There is no forgiveness of sins except by the shedding of blood, according to the book of Hebrews. So the blood of Jesus cleanses us from our sins, but we still have a problem. We're a sinner. We're prone to sin. We want to sin. We are a sin factory. We're a little sin engine. Everywhere we go, we produce sin. So what was God's response to the sinner? The cross. That is the answer. The blood is the answer for the forgiveness of sins, and the cross is the answer to the sinner. We have to be crucified with Christ, amen? Crucified even daily, amen? Let's turn to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. Paul said, but I say, walk by the Spirit. And if you do, you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. Now, how do we know if we're in the Spirit? Well, if we walk according to Spirit, we're going to be in harmony with the commandments of God. Amen. If we walk according to the Spirit, then our life is not going to produce the deeds of the flesh. Amen. Now that's not saying temporarily you might not do something wrong. Oh, you will. Now listen. Christians are oftentimes labeled as hypocrites, and probably most of the Christian world are hypocrites. Most people who profess the name are hypocrites. Hypocrite just means actor, and they're acting the act. They're not really living the life of Christ. It's not really Christ's life in them. It's their life in them. I mean, the seed of Christ is not producing the fruits of the Holy Spirit, the fruit of gentleness, of patience, of love, of kindness. No, they just see in the Bible, in the flesh, they see that that's what a Christian is supposed to look like, so they tape little plastic, got me a little orange of gentleness here, and give me that apple of patience over here, temperance over here. A little fig of temperance or something. It's not real. It's produced by the flesh. It's actors. It looks good on the outside, but take a bite of it. I took a bite of a bar of soap once when I was a kid. You know why? I thought it was a zero candy bar. I'm sorry, I was stupid. You might say, well, you ain't changed. I should have known better. Who puts a zero on the bathtub? I was little, but you know what? I found out it wasn't a zero candy bar. It didn't taste good at all. Tasted awful. Now, I'm not really that stupid. If I was really stupid, I would have taken a second bite just to be sure. But I did. But something that is not real has no useful value, just like an imitation fruit. It's only there to appear, to be something it really isn't. Listen to me. You will produce whatever from whatever seed is planted in you. Is that right or wrong? Can an apple tree produce oranges? Fig tree doesn't produce, you know, apples. Whatever is planted, that it will produce after its own kind. Amen. So if Jesus is planted in us, then what will be manifested in our life, we don't do it. We don't say, oh man, I've got to try real hard to be more gentle. I've got to try real hard to be patient. And I can't wait until I am patient. I can't wait. I'm in a hurry to be patient. You see, that's not how it is. You allow God to plant Jesus in you, and then you get out of the way. And by that I mean you set your eyes on the things of the Spirit. You set your eyes on heavenly things. You set your eyes on the will of God, on the Word of God, on doing the things pleasing to God. You want to please Him because He's your Father. He wants to please you. The Bible says in His right hand are pleasures forevermore. The Bible says in His presence is the fullness of joy. You know what? You and I have never felt the fullness of joy. We felt joy, but we've never felt the fullness of joy. What is it like to feel the fullness of joy? There's no room for any more joy. I mean, what is that like? We're going to know. Now, you know, we have experienced the presence of God in part, the manifest presence of God. But one day, we're going to live in the fullness of joy. We're going to live in pleasures forevermore. That's glorious. That's glorious indeed. And we can't produce those things in the flesh. Those things are only, they spring and grow from the Spirit. So if we look at our lives and we say, okay, well, let me finish what I was saying. Sometimes you can look at a Christian and you can't tell much difference between a Christian and a sinner. Because Christians still struggle, but they're forgiven. The difference is a Christian hates sin. A Christian doesn't agree with his sin. A Christian is like the Apostle Paul in Romans 7. He says, I do the very thing I hate. And if I'm doing the very thing I hate, then it can't be me. It has to be this body of death that is present with me at all time. And so his conclusion over in chapter 8 was, therefore, I've concluded there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Yes, I find myself doing. You have a, David, let me borrow you for a minute. David, you're facing the kingdom, and I'm facing the lake of fire. Now, looks like we're at the same place. People on the outside say, well, there ain't no difference between them. This, he can be thinking, well, I could be thinking, I'm just as good as him. Look at him. I'm right here with him. He got the same problems I got. He got some of the same struggles I got. Yeah, I'm watching him. I see him. He ain't nothing but a hypocrite, you see. Oh, he talks the talk, but he don't walk the walk. But guess where his eyes are? See, his eyes are on Jesus. Where is he moving toward? What's he facing? Which way is he traveling? You see, he's traveling the right way. You see. Now, as this journey goes on, we're going to be quite a far apart. Because I'm going the wrong way and he's going that way. Pretty soon I'm going to look around and say, I don't know where he is, because he's going from glory to glory. He's being transformed into the likeness of Christ Jesus. You see, the struggles of the flesh are beginning to just fall off of him as he becomes divinely powerful in the spirit, you see, because he's keeping his eyes on Jesus. He's keeping his eyes on the goal, the prize of his high calling. And I'm not. I'm just meandering down, just looking to see what in the world that is drawing me. And I say, I think I like this, and I'll go over here on this wide road, and whatever pleases my heart at the moment, that's what I choose. So it can look to someone in the world, even to me. You know, there's always going to be people that look like, you know, a lot of people find comfort in the fact that they'll say, well, I'm just as committed as some of the Christians I know. Well, if they're true Christians, you're not. If you're not committed to Christ, you aren't. Just because you may be at the same mile marker doesn't mean a thing. It's which direction you're facing, which direction you're going. Because the direction we go is going to determine the destination. Amen. One leads to life and one leads to death in the lake of fire. Amen. Okay, now verse 16 again. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. So what is the answer to not carry out the desire of the flesh? Walk by the Spirit. Let us live by the Spirit. That means let us get out of the way and let Christ live his life in us. Don't quench the Spirit. What quenches the Spirit? Well, fulfilling the desires of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. Now, you see this? Now, what Paul is saying is that the flesh and the Spirit are enemies. There's a war going on between the Spirit and the flesh. Amen. What side are we on? Are we living in the flesh, or are we living in the Spirit? You know, people sin. They're not sinners because they sin. They sin because they're sinners. The Bible says we're conceived in sin. David said, I was conceived in sin. Romans chapter 6 or 5 says that we're sinners because Adam sinned. Because of one transgression, his transgression, we're sinners. Now, did we all follow after him? Did we all sin in his likeness? Maybe not exactly in his likeness, but we all practice sin. But that's because it's in our nature. We're born according to our nature. That's why we have to have another birth. That's why we have to have a spiritual birth. We have to be born of a spirit nature, a nature where Christ, the risen nature, you know, there is no sin. Adam cannot do anything. He cannot practice righteousness. Can he do something righteous once in a while? Yeah, but he can't practice righteousness. And Christ cannot practice sin. Amen? So Adam can't be rehabilitated. I mean, Adam has to die. And that means when we say that, we're saying, let's don't feed the dead man. Let's don't feed the flesh. Let's feed the Spirit. That means let's do whatever the Word of God says. Let's do whatever Jesus is moving us to do. And let's don't feed the desires of the flesh. Amen? But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envying, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these of which I forewarn you, just as I have forewarned you, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Look, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 says, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Now, we're becoming one or the other. Amen. We're going to become one or the other. We can go back. We can go back to Adam. We can go back. Just like a sow can go back to wallowing in the mire. But we don't want to go back. Amen. But the fruit of the Spirit, and this is fruit of the Spirit, this is what the Spirit in us will produce. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Did you hear that? Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Now these passions will come up. These passions will tempt you. These will come up and say, receive me. Act upon this temptation. And it's then where we say no. And we can say no because the power of the Spirit in us, the power of the life of Christ in us, is divinely powerful. Amen? Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. 2 Corinthians chapter 13. 2 Corinthians 13. The flesh is forever linked with Adam, brethren, and the Spirit is forever linked to Christ Jesus. You know, we're going to do one work or the other. We're going to do our work. Are we going to allow God to do His work in us? There's a lot of people who name the name of Christ that will stand before Jesus at judgment. We see in Matthew chapter 7. And they will announce to Jesus and all the holy angels all the things they've done in His name. Well, we cast out demons in Your name. We raised the dead in Your name. We performed many miracles in Your name. We preached in Your name. We did missionary work in Your name. We did charitable functions in Your name. We fed the poor in Your name. We gave our body to be burned in Your name. I'm paraphrasing. I'm adding 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And you know what He'll say? He'll say, depart from me. I never knew you. Depart from me. And He says, why? You practice lawlessness. You did what you did. It was your life. Oh, you lived your life in my name, but that's it. It was your life. It was the life of the flesh. You never came out of Adam, or you came out of Adam and went back into Adam. One or the other. And you were lawless. Now notice here in 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Verse 1. Paul is correcting the Corinthians. He said, this is the third time I'm coming to you, and every fact is to be confirmed by the testimony of two or three witnesses. So he's got a problem he's got to deal with in the church there. I have previously said, when present the second time, and though now absent, I say in advance of those who have sinned in the past, and to all the rest as well, that if I come again, I will not spare anyone. He's saying, this is the third time I've got to come to deal with this problem. Now, you're supposed to be the church of the living God. You're supposed to be the pillar and the ground of the truth. You're supposed to be the body of Christ. You're supposed to be the fullness of deity dwelling in Him in bodily form. And as he said in his first letter, but you're acting like mere men. You're acting like flesh. And you're going astray. You're becoming flesh. And he says, verse 3, since you are seeking for proof of the Christ who speaks in me and who is not weak toward you, but mighty in you. So he's saying, oh, you're questioning my apostleship? For indeed, he was crucified because of weakness, yet he lives because of the power of God. For we also are weak in him, yet we will live with him because of the power of God directed toward you. Now notice verse 5. Test yourselves. Examine yourselves. Test yourselves to see if you are in the faith. Examine yourselves. Or do you not recognize this about yourselves, that Christ Jesus is in you? Unless indeed you fail the test. Literally in the Greek, it means you become unapproved. You will not be approved by God. Test yourselves to make sure you're in Christ Jesus. How do we do that? Let's go over to 1 John chapter 3. Well, I test myself. I just believe that I am. I look in a mirror and I say, I know you're in there, Lord. I know you're there. Well, that really is not the way to test, is it? We find really how to test in 1 John chapter 3. Notice verse 1. John said, see how great a love the Father has bestowed on us, that we would be called children of God, and such we are. For this reason, the world does not know us. For what reason? We're the children of God. The world doesn't recognize us because it did not know Him. You know, if it didn't recognize Jesus, it don't recognize us. Amen. Beloved, now we are the children of God, and it has not yet appeared to us what we will be, but we know when He appears, we will be like Him, because we will see Him as He is. Hallelujah. And everyone who has this hope fixes hope fixed on Him, purifies himself. Isn't that simple? Isn't that what I'm saying? Whatever you put your eyes on, whatever is your most dominant thought. And listen, if you have a most dominant thought that feeds the flesh, then you just have to pray for God to purify your heart. Ask God to sprinkle your heart clean by the blood of Jesus. David cried out in Psalm 51 after his sin with Bathsheba and Uriah. He said, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit in me. He knew he wasn't right. He knew he had sinned. I mean, this was David, a man after God's own heart, that had committed adultery. And then he had committed murder. And he was so deluded, he didn't even know. He had drifted so far away, he didn't even realize how deep he was in sin until God sent Nathan the prophet. And Nathan told him a little story about a man who took somebody else's little lamb. And David was furious. Sounds hypocritical, doesn't it? I'm not judging David. He's going to rule all Israel in the millennium. A great man. But that just shows how sin can easily deceive us and entangle us. And he told David that little story, and David was indignant, said, that man will pay. And Nathan said, that man is you. And Bathsheba is that little lamb that you took. And David was convicted. And there was terrible consequences, even though God said, do Nathan, God has forgiven you. Amen. But we purify. Notice, and everyone who has this hope, what hope? To be found in the likeness of Christ at His return. To be a part of the first resurrection. Everyone who has this hope fixed on Him, that is on Christ, purifies himself. You know why people don't purify themselves? Because they're not seeking the Lord. That's simple. Listen, you just look around and you see what people do and you can see what they're pursuing. Is that right or wrong? I mean, listen, if you've got 4 or 5 trees out there and somebody goes up, you've got an orange tree, an apple tree, a fig tree, and a pear tree. Now, if someone goes up to an apple tree, you know that's what they want. That's what they're seeking. And you never see someone go up to an apple tree and say, I was hoping to find a pear. I mean, they know better. They go to an apple tree because that's what they want. That's why I say we will get what we want. We just have to be careful what we want. We need to educate our hearts and our minds, see, on what we want. So everyone who has this hope, verse 3, fixed on Jesus, purifies himself. People who don't purify themselves, their eyes are not fixed on Jesus. They do not value Jesus. And if you don't value Jesus, you don't really value who he is and what he is. He is the life. He is the resurrection. You see? He is the Savior. There's no salvation through anyone else. Everyone who practices sin. Now this isn't, I messed up today. Or I messed up 80 times today. That's not what this is. This is someone who practices sin as a way of life. Everyone who practices sin practices lawlessness, because the law of God in its simplest form is simply the instruction of God. And sin is lawlessness. That means violating the instruction of God, whether it be the commandments, whether it be any other law or any other word from God. You know that he appeared in order to what? Take away sins. And in him there is no sin. Now listen. You need to believe it. But in Christ Jesus, we are without sin. In Christ Jesus, we're blameless. Now somebody outside, the devil will always accuse you, and he'll have people accuse you. You're not without sin. You lied yesterday. I know you did something wrong. It's not imputed to you. When you're in Christ Jesus, go straight to the cross. It's not imputed. He appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins, that is, practices sin. No one who sins has seen him or knows him. Verse 7, little children, make sure no one deceives you. Now, see, John is saying, and, you know, by the time John wrote this, these are the last writings of the Bible. You know, he wasn't even accepted in some of the churches. You know, we find that in his third letter, a man named Diotrephes had gained power and wouldn't even accept this last apostle or his teachings. So he's saying, verse 7, little children, make sure no one deceives you. The one who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who practices sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. And in order to do that for you and I, it's not enough to wash away our sins. He has to destroy the sin factory. He has to destroy the sin producer, which is who we were in Adam. But in Christ, we're holy and righteous, blameless. And not only that, we're justified. Romans chapter 5 says, and chapter 4, the last of 4 says, we're justified. That means that there's no record that we've ever sinned at all. We've been examined and been found completely innocent. You know why? Because God has given us not a changed life. We are not pardoned criminals. You see, we have been made into a position of where we've never sinned. Not by our own, but by the glory of God. By His. I mean, we thank the Lord for that. Amen. We have received an exchanged life. He took the life of Adam and gave us His life. So verse 10, by this the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God. That's how we test ourselves. Nor the one who does not love his brother. For this is a message which you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Now notice this, not as Cain, you know, Cain killed his brother Abel. Not as Cain, who was of the evil one. Now, Cain wasn't born of the evil one initially. I mean, he was Adam and Eve's child, Adam and Eve's son. But he received the word, which is the seed of the devil. Remember Matthew chapter 13, the parable Jesus gave of the sower. It says, you know, that the enemy went out and sowed seeds. Well, those are his words, which you can receive. Those are his thoughts. That's why we're told in Corinthians to capture every thought and bring it to the obedience of Christ. Well, Cain received a thought from the devil to kill his brother, and he acted upon that thought, and because of that he became a child of the devil, just like the Pharisees had become children of the devil when they became enemies of Christ. So notice here, not as Cain, who was of the evil one and slew his brother. And notice, and for what reason did he slay him? Because his deeds were evil and his brother's were righteous. Forget about, you know, who sacrificed what. That was beside the point. Do you think God is going to receive any kind? You think Cain, if he had gone out and took something from the flock and came and brought it to the Lord, that the Lord would have received his offering if his deeds were evil? No. And if his deeds were not evil, would not God receive the offerings from his harvest? Of course he would. God would receive the offering. But he's not going to receive an offering from someone who is evil, that's practicing evil. Amen. And so what was the problem between Cain and Abel? Why did Cain hate Abel? Because Abel was righteous. Jesus called Abel righteous in Matthew chapter 23. And Cain's deeds were evil. Therefore, whoever does evil hates the one who does righteous. The children of the devil hate the children of God. That's just the way it is. One are born of the flesh, the other of the spirit. Notice, not as Cain, who was of the evil one and slew his brother. And for what reason did he slay him? Because his deeds were evil and his brother's deeds were righteous. So notice, it says, do not be surprised, brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed out of death into life. How do we know? Because we love the brethren. He who does not love abides in death. Love is as love does. You know what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Love does not seek its own interests. Love is not envious, is not jealous. You see? I love that. Love does not seek its own interests, but seeks the interests of others. You don't look to yourself first. You lay down your life for the sake of others. That's Christ's way. That's Christ's life in us. Amen. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brethren. He who does not love abides in death. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. We know love by this, that we lay down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. And notice verse 18, little children, let us not love with word or with tongue, but in deed and in truth. Verse 24, the one who keeps his commandments abides in him. How do we live in the Spirit? We allow Christ to walk the same walk. We keep his commandments. We don't quench the Spirit. We obey God. And if we look at our life and we say, okay, we are obeying God. We're not, you know, we're following in his footsteps. We're obeying his commandments. And we are suppressing and, you know, and capturing every thought that feeds the flesh. Then we know that we are abiding in Christ. Verse 24 again. The one who keeps his commandments abides in him, and he in him. We know by this that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. The Spirit in us. That's how we know. Amen. All right, let's turn over to Romans chapter 8. We'll conclude there. On this warm day. Well, let's just do a little highlighting. Turn back to chapter 5, verse 18. Notice, so then as through one transgression, there resulted condemnation to all men. We're talking about Adam's sin. Even so, through one act of righteousness, there resulted justification of life to all men. For as through the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners. How were we made sinners? By Adam's sin. Now, did we follow in his footsteps? Of course. You know why? Because we have his nature. Even so, through the obedience of the one, the many will be made righteous. Now, when we have the nature of Jesus, then our life is righteous. Not because we produce the righteousness, but because we received his life. Amen. Knowing, and then chapter 6, verse 5, for if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him, in order that our body of sin might be done away with. That's what I was talking about earlier, that God can wash away our sins by the blood, but it takes crucifixion to kill the sinner, to render the sinner inoperative. That the body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. And notice, for he who has died is free from sin. And then he goes on to say, don't let sin reign in your mortal bodies. Now over in chapter 7, Paul is saying, well, why is it? I agree with the law of God, but why is it that I find myself doing the very things I hate? He said, you know, but he says, it's that body of sin that is present with me at all times. Now, notice verse 24. Wretched man that I am, of chapter 7, who will set me free from the body of this death? And he says, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, on the one hand, I myself with my mind am serving the law of God, but on the other, with my flesh, the law of sin. So we find that there is a law of sin. Amen. Now notice verse 1 of chapter 8. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Notice, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Now this is a new law. What was God's response to dealing with, what was his response with dealing with sin? The blood of Jesus. What was his response with dealing with Adam? It was crucifixion. What was his response with dealing with the law of sin and death? Well, to create a law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. What does that mean? It means that as we live in this world, gravity pulls everything down, you see. That's the law of sin and death. It pulls everything down, see. But what happens is, when God makes a new law, he comes in with the law of the Spirit of life in Christ. And even though gravity is still pulling on my glasses here, it stays. It's sustained. Do you know why it's sustained? Because God dealt with that law with a new law, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Amen. So now we're in chapter 8, where we'll conclude. Verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. We need to live in Christ, live in the Spirit. Live there, amen? I mean, live there. Don't let anything take you out of there. Don't let temptation bring you out of the Spirit into the flesh. Fight that fight, like Paul talked about. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, and the law could not save us, it could only reveal to us what sin was. It could reveal to us what God wanted us to do. But without the Spirit, we didn't have the power to do it. We could do part of it, part of the time, but not all the time. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us. And the requirement, of course, was death. Who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who are according to the Spirit, they set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For the mind set on the flesh is death. But the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. I think I choose life and peace. Amen. Because the mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God. For it does not submit itself to the law of God. What does that tell us? That means that the Spirit does submit itself to the law of God. Amen. The law has a role. The law is not there to save us. Law is there to reveal what sin is and to reveal the will of God, the instruction of God. Because the mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God, for it does not subject itself to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. However, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. If Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. So then, brethren, we are under obligation not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. But if you are living according to the flesh, you must die. Either Adam is going to die at the cross with Christ, or Adam is going to perish in the lake of fire. And either we're going to be identified with Adam in the flesh, or we're going to be identified with the last Adam, Adam in the spirit, which is Christ Jesus. And it is our choice. For if you are living according to the flesh, verse 13, you must die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, in other words, the pulls of the flesh, the deeds of the flesh, you will live. If you're fighting the fight, when the temptation comes up and you see that it is hostile toward God, that it is trying to destroy the spirit life in you, and you say no, all you have to do is take the step. Our weapons are divinely powerful, pulling down any stronghold of Satan. We all know that, brethren. Listen, we've all had situations. We've all had been in situations where, you know, normally, if we find ourselves in some type of a crisis, we try to deal with it, don't we? I mean, it's a natural thing. We try to deal with it the best we can. But sometimes we face situations where, you know what, this is bigger than me. I know I can't do this. I can't handle this. There's nothing I can do myself. And oftentimes we wait till we get to that point where we then say, Lord, I've got to give it to you because I can't handle it. Let's see. Of course, we can't handle lots of things that we think we can. But when we finally come to a point where we say, I know I can't handle this, and we turn it over to God, have you ever noticed what kind of peace comes over you? Have you ever noticed where there's no struggle anymore? If you notice, think about it. Just think about that. There's no struggle anymore. There's a peace. Because you're not doing it anymore. You say, Lord, I'm letting you do it. And you step the flesh part of you, the body of death, you get out of the way and you let God. Listen, rarely is a manifestation of God, it will never be in you. It will be in Christ's life. If Christ's life is in you, yes, but it'll never be in who you are in Adam. Christ's life will never be able to be made manifest there. We were resurrected with Christ. But we can do that on smaller things too. We can learn to do that all the time. We can say, you know what? I'm not going to be concerned about this. I'm going to turn this over to the Lord. I'm going to put my focus on God, and I'm going to let Him deal with the other stuff. Amen. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but have received a spirit of adoption as sons, by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with Him, so that we may be glorified with Him. Amen. Hallelujah. Would you all rise?